Hello and welcome to Film Byte. I'm Kyle Mark Walter. Today I'm bringing you the second episode of my series, Next on Your List, where I highlight movies or shows on streaming services that you should, or maybe should not, check out. Let's get started. Today I'm going to highlight five pieces of media that are on Netflix right now that you can check out. And I'm going to start by talking about three documentary series that are on Netflix. Documentary series are a place that Netflix is really shining right now. They have a variety of really great series that either they're producing or getting from other companies and putting on their platform for us to be able to enjoy. Today I want to highlight three of those. First, I want to start with Hitler's Circle of Evil. This is a 10-part documentary series that follows Hitler and the people and politicians closest to him from about 1919 until the fall of the Third Reich in 1945. Now, unlike a lot of other World War II documentaries in the series, this one is really, really laser-focused. It centers directly on those individuals that were particularly close to Hitler in his political sphere. Talking about people like Joseph Goebbels or Heinrich Himmler, Albert Speer, and those people who helped raise him to power and then support his government. Through interviews with historians and then recreated flashbacks, you get this 10-part sequence of events from the beginning to the end. The historical commentary, while one could argue is pretty melodramatic at times, does a really good job of opening up a lot of the places in that history that are often brushed under the rug when we learn, at least here in the United States, about the history of World War II. The recreations are also at times a little over the top, almost sort of like you could think of it as almost like reality show-esque, but the information contained in the series itself and the way it is presented is incredibly gripping and engaging. I would highly recommend it, especially if you are a World War II or a history buff. Check it out. While not the perfect documentary series, it is incredibly informative and an engaging watch all the way through. I'll give it 3 out of 5 bites. Next up, I'd like to highlight a series called Taco Chronicles from 2019. This is a 6-episode series that explores 6 different types of tacos in Mexico. It explores some types of tacos that you might be familiar with, like carnitas or pastor, but also branches out into some of the lesser known types of tacos. Tacos de canasta and guisado and things like that. But what elevates this documentary series, I think, above a lot of other ones is how the documentarians have explored not only the food itself, but the people and the culture around that food. For example, when they explore carnitas, we get to see one of the locations where these tacos are popular, where they're from, but also a lot of the cultural elements that go into making those tacos from, in this case, the pans that they're made in, to the locations in which they are made. It is amazingly well interviewed. The interviewers have gotten these really expressive, energetic, entertaining comments and informative lectures, if you will, from the people they're interviewing, interspersed with a sense of humor that just makes you smile the whole time, and just a love for the food and the place that people are talking about. It is definitely one not to watch on an empty stomach. I watched all the episodes after having eaten, did that as a deliberate choice. I would recommend you doing that too. I would give this 4 out of 5 bites for Taco Chronicles. Next up, I'd like to highlight a series called Home Game. This one's really recent, from last month, June of 2020. Home Game is a documentary series that has 8 episodes. That follow competitions of 8 different traditional sports, if you will, from around the world. While some of the sports might be at least a little familiar to you, things like the Highland Games or roller derby, the filmmakers have chosen to highlight some really incredible sports from around the world. The first episode, Calcio Storico, is a sport that is played only in Florence, Italy. But we get to explore all over the world. We go to Kyrgyzstan and we see Coq Buru, and we get to go to the Congo and see Catch Fatish. And the way that we, as the viewers, get to really sit in these sports and listen to the people who play them, who compete in them, who watch them, is incredibly eye-opening, not only about the sports themselves, but the things that draws people to sports in general. The filmmakers have done a really good job of finding people who are interesting to talk to, who can speak knowledgeably about the sports and the competitions that each episode focuses on. But I think the structure of each episode is part of what makes it so engaging. Each episode essentially follows competitors who will eventually meet by the end of the episode at some big competition within their sport. So you get this kind of back and forth as you talk to people on either side of this upcoming competition in this kind of countdown format as the days progress. 5 days till the competition, 2 days to the competition, 1 day to the competition. And we get to hear them and see them as they prepare for their matches or their sport. But then also hear how the sport either comes from who they are, their culture, what draws them to that sport, the passion they have for it, the passion their country has for that sport. Amazingly entertaining, really inspirational at times, watching some of these people compete in these awe-inspiring sports. I would highly recommend watching at least the episode on KeKeRuX, if not anything else, but it's hard to pick a favorite episode from within there. All of them, for the most part, are really solid. One or two sort of weak moments in there where some of the maybe the focus gets a little hard to find in the episode. But in general, amazing, highly entertaining, worth watching, incredibly informative. I'd give it 4 out of 5 bites for Home Game. Next up, I'd like to highlight the 2019 animated film Klaus, which is on Netflix. It's a Netflix film made by a studio set up in Spain by actually an animator who had worked in Disney or at Disney for a few years, I guess more than a few years, worked on quite a number of Disney films, and then set up a studio in Spain where he was interested in trying to kind of go back to the roots of animation, do 2D animation, as if that format, that genre, that style had continued without 3D animation as we know it now, since so much of animation since the 90s has been taken over by 3D animation. The director's name is Sergio Pablos, and he and his team have done an amazing job. The film essentially follows the journey of a lazy, wealthy son of a postmaster general somewhere in the far north of Europe. Sweden, Finland, Norway area. It's left kind of deliberately vague. And we watch his journey as his father, in an effort to help his son better himself, assigns him to the far north town of Smeerensburg. The main character, Jesper Johansson, is played by Jason Schwartzman, who does an amazing job. And Jesper, when he arrives there, finds the town is embroiled in a long-standing feud between two families. Jesper's father tasks him with the job of getting 6,000 letters through the small post office in this town of Smeerensburg. So Jesper hatches a plan to be able to get those letters through by the time his father has requested. He decides to have the kids start writing letters to this man who delivers toys named Klaus. The film is essentially an alternate telling of the story of Santa Claus, and is incredibly well voiced. You have quite an amazing amount of talent in there. Jason Schwartzman, J.K. Simmons plays Klaus, Rashida Jones plays a love interest Alva, Joan Cusack plays the matriarch of one of the warring families. And the story itself, while maybe at the start kind of seems this sort of high concept idea of like, this guy needs to get these letters by this set time or he'll lose the sort of the comfort he's familiar with, and it's this internal growth story, that is true, but it is an incredibly touching and emotional film as you learn more about what motivates some of these characters, what's behind them, what they've lived through, why they act the way that they do, and then the growth that they make feels really deserved. It brought tears to my eyes at different times. It is quite a powerful story, especially if you have younger children. It's one that should now regularly be included maybe in your cycle of Christmas movies. It also did really well last year in the awards season. It won at the British Academy Film Awards for Best Animated Film and swept every single category it was in at the Annie Awards earlier this year. I think it was 7 different categories, including for Best Animated Film that's not an independent film. It gave it 3.5 out of 5 bites. Finally, I want to wrap up with the 2017 film, Good Time. This is the Safdie Brothers film that preceded Uncut Gems that came out this past year with Adam Sandler. Good Time follows the story of Constantine, they call him Connie, Nikas, and his brother, Nick, Nicholas. Connie and Nick's family has not been particularly stable, and Nick suffers from a disability. Connie forces Nick into a robbery to get some money to help them out. The robbery goes wrong, and Nick is taken into custody by the police. Connie is left on the run in an effort to try to clean up the situation and get enough money to help his family out, as well as to help Nick out of the situation that he's now found himself in. The story itself has a lot of potential and is reminiscent of things like Dog Day Afternoon, but this film lacks a lot of substance that I think that other really truly great crime and heist films really possess. Part of it is that this film maybe navigates a difficult boundary. It at times seems overly indulgent, even exploitative, in particular of some of the minority characters in the film that are kind of constantly pushed aside or abused or mistreated without it being really part of the main, you know, point or themes of this story. And that left a sour taste in my mouth, as well as the fact that there's not really a lot of thematic substance underneath it. This film, among critics, has been fairly divisive. It gained a lot of attention when it came out and was even, you know, competing at some of the big festivals around the world. But I think that I more agree with A.O. Scott's take on the film. Scott said this in his New York Times review. "Sometimes it flaunts its cliches. Nick's disability and Benny Safdie's slack-jawed portrayal of it is a big one. And other times, it cloaks them in rough visual textures and jumpy, bumpy camera movements so that a rickety genre thrill ride feels like something daring and new. It isn't. It's stale, empty, and cold." And I would agree with that. That's how I very much came out of the movie. But the one saving grace that I felt in there was Robert Pattinson's portrayal of Connie. Robert Pattinson has grown to be an incredible actor, and his ability is on high display here. He really does an amazing job, brings a physicality to it, brings a wonderful sort of character actor's portrayal of this New York guy on the run. In general, I wouldn't recommend it, actually. I would give it 2 out of 5 bites. That's it for today. I hope that you check out my recommendations, and I hope to see you back here soon. Please subscribe, and thank you for watching Film Bite.